Good morning. Jesus has risen, and that's why we're here today to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And what a beautiful opportunity he has once again for us to come into his house and worship this day. Do have a few announcements this morning to bring to our attention. A couple of them from the women's department. The first one, the women's department of Parkview is compiling a collection of your testimonies or those from relatives, parents, grandparents. Along with these, the testimonies may be ones which burn brightly in your lives from times past, like those from Al Stanley, Arthur Rock, Henry Schaefer, or many others. Do you have a favorite testimony of the saints that you would like to share with the Parkview family? The Women's Department is compiling these. You can see Courtney Brock by November 1st, and they're going to publish those on the Parkview website to add with those that Neil has already got out there. So it's a beautiful opportunity to share in those testimonies of those who have gone before us. Also, another one from the Women's Department is planning to make blessing bags. These would be accessible to anyone in the congregation who would like to keep a few in their car for handing out to the homeless or needy as they feel led. We are requesting donations for this project. The bags will be in 1 gallon Ziplocs for easy handling. So items need to be small individual packages that are easily opened by the recipient. There are boxes in the back classroom down here on the hall on the far right for those donations. The deadline will be October the 29th. So thank you for considering a contribution to this ministry. If anyone prefers to donate money or make purchases, please see Courtney Brock or Myra Boyd. There is a suggestion list on the bulletin board in the hallway down there by the pastor's office. So be mindful of that. A good opportunity to reach out and help those in our community who are definitely in need. I received a invitation from the Green Valley congregation. They are having their annual fall celebration. I'll post this back there on the wall somewhere on the bulletin board. That'll be on the 21st of October from 2 to 6 p.m. That is a Saturday. They'll have the petting zoo, and in the petting zoo, there are camels and kangaroos and more little exotic animals. There'll be pony rides, a bounce house, it's food, drinks, and games. We've been the last couple of 3 years, and it's always a fun time to go share with the Green Valley congregation. So that's the 21st of October, 2 to 6 p.m. Also to bring to our attention, on Sunday, October 29th, the church, the Community of Christ Church, has set aside that as a day of fasting and prayer. As you know, Brother Steve Vesey has been, he announced his retirement, and then he became ill. And so the Council of 12 has decided to seek out some divine intervention and understanding regarding the future and the leadership of the church. So they'd ask everyone to join with them on October 29th as a day of fasting and prayer, and we'll continue to uphold them and that ministry. There are a lot of events transpiring within the church, within the world, that each of us need to be mindful of and to seek our Heavenly Father for his direction and intervention as we go forward. Also, just as a reminder, we're getting to that time of year when maybe church might be postponed due to inclement weather or other events or activities. I had to cancel the priesthood meeting last week ago yesterday. There was the funeral of Doris Pugh that was at the same time. And so rather than have a conflict, I canceled the meeting. I made the announcement that Wednesday evening at prayer service, sent it out on the prayer chain and also on the Parkview Facebook page. But not everybody got that, and I understand there was some that showed up for the meeting. And so I apologize for that, but I used the best means available that we have to communicate that with people. If you're not on the prayer chain, I would encourage you to do so. You can contact Stephanie Chapman. She sends out text messages, so if you have the capability to receive a text message, just get hold of Stephanie. She'll add you to the list, and you can also get those notifications. I'm considering... If you look through the church directory, it seems like probably 90% of the people have an email address as you go through there. There's only like 15 who don't have all the families or individuals listed. So if I might recruit somebody that could put together a mass mailing list And everybody has emails, it seems like, these days, that maybe that's a good opportunity, another way to get the message out, particularly with the fall upon us and the winter months coming, in case we have to cancel due to inclement weather or some other situation that might come up. So if somebody is good at typing and wants to put together that list, I would greatly appreciate that. My typing skills, I would be here till next winter trying to get that together. So any other announcements this morning before we would enter into our hour of worship? If not, would you bow with me? Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this Sabbath day. Father, we thank you for the changing of the seasons and for the beauty that surrounds us. Father, might we be mindful of you in all that we see and do. And we pray this day as we come to worship, you might bless us as we lift up our voice in song, as we hear those gifts and talents offered this day through the music of playing and singing. Might it touch our hearts, Father, and lift us up unto you. We pray that you would bless us as we would hear your word that is brought forth, that through this, Father, we might recognize the importance of coming to that closer walk and relationship with you. So we just praise you and thank you, Father, for this opportunity. Pray you'd bless us in our coming week and our activities. There is much going on within our lives here in the congregation. Bless us in our times of fellowship and worship, and as we would gather wherever we might be. So we just praise you and thank you and ask for your goodness and your blessings upon us this day. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning. My brothers and I welcome you this morning to the house of our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to thank Amy and Mary, Caleb, Jonathan for bringing their ministry this morning to us also. It's my prayer that we come this morning united. United as families, united as a people. And to come with the Spirit in our heart. And I would ask an interest in your prayers for all of us this morning. That not just us four on the podium, but for each and every one of us. For I know we all need those prayers. But I especially ask that you would uphold my brother David this morning. A little bit of joking in the back. In my prayer, I ask our Heavenly Father to be with our David, Brother David, for the 20, 30, or 2 hours that he stands this day to bring the ministry. And we kind of laughed and joked about it, but in reality, it's not my brother David. They'll be bringing the message today. Is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The message has been placed upon his heart. So I would ask that you would uphold him. Call to worship this morning. Boy. Comes from 1 Chronicles, chapter 29, starting with verse 10. Wherefore David blessed the Lord before all the congregations. And David said, Blessed be thou, Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Thine, O Lord, in the generation, the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty of all that is in heaven and in earth is thine. Thine is the kingdom, O Lord, and thou art exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come of thee, and thou reignest over all, and in thy hand is power and might, and in thy hand it is to make great, and to give strength unto all. Now therefore, our God, we thank thee and praise thy glorious name. Let us this day, as our brother David did, raise our voices to our God, and to give him total thanks for all. For we know and understand that all that we have, even our very lives this day, comes from him.
Thank you. O God, the Eternal Father, we thank Thee for the spirit that we feel when we come into this sanctuary. We pray that our minds may be united in one as we hear the word which You have prepared for us through Thy speaker, David, and that You would also help him with his coughing, that he might be able to speak clearly and that we might all understand wisely. May Your will be done in this day, Father, and for we know that Thou art and that Thou art always with us when we come unto You. Thank You and bless us this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Will you pray with me? Our loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we come before You this day to give Thee thanks, Father, to thank You for all the great gifts and the blessings You have bestowed upon each and every one of us and upon our families and upon our congregation, Father. We thank Thee, Lord, for hearing our prayers and answering those prayers, Father, in the most great and glorious way. We understand, Father, that everything, and we know in our hearts that all comes from You. And what we give back to You this day, Father, is our love and our faith. For what we are about to give, Father, monetarily, we know You really don't need it to bring forth Thy kingdom. But You've called us forth, Father, to do this out of faith. So, Father, we ask that You make bless this money and put it to the use that You see fit, that we may fulfill Thy kingdom. And we ask that You may continue to be with us each and every one. In Christ's name we pray.
Selected two scriptures to set the tone of this service today. First comes from 1 Thessalonians 5, 16 to 18. Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And the second comes from Ephesians 5, 20. Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one.
I, King of heaven, my victory.
O bright heaven sun, art of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all. Thou and thou
speech classes or any type of public speaking, they always tell you not to apologize whenever you start your sermon or your speech. But I feel I need to apologize in a sense because I was given the opportunity to come back out of my short retirement and be in a classroom with students again. And I'm with a bunch of elementary school students, and one in particular has been coughing a lot and plays with his snotty nose all the time. One of those fears I had and why I didn't want to be an elementary teacher, that was one of my worries. However, the other side of it that you don't realize, or that I didn't realize, maybe some of you did, is that when you do lunch duty, you get to be around a bunch of kindergartners, and the thing they like to do is give you hugs, you know. And I really like that, you know. I wouldn't have liked it if I'd have been at the high school and they were trying to give me hugs, but I liked it there. I'm liking it that. It's been interesting, to say the least, and I'm just getting started. It is definitely a different beast than high school. I also wanted to share, for those of you that are interested or are aware, that I got to visit with Don Herring again the other day, and he's doing very well. And has appreciated the visits. There's been a number of individuals that have gone up and said hi and taken him a Diet Coke or just visited for a little bit. And so I wanted to share that with you. And also, although Tony's not here, I feel like that I wanted to thank him for putting that on Facebook, because that did make it available to people who may not have been aware of where he was or how he was doing. So those are little sidebars there, but it kind of runs with my theme that I have felt led to work on. I've known about this sermon for quite some time. I don't know just how long it's been. Ken could probably tell you, because he's the one that called and asked me, but I told my wife this morning, if you looked on my flash drive, I've got like four different sermons on this topic, and each one didn't seem quite right. And then this morning I had one all set up that I'd done the other day, and it didn't seem right either. And so this is number five, I guess you would call it, of this. But the one thing that did not change and did not vary was the theme that seemed to strike me is giving thanks. That's where my I feel thankful that I was given the opportunity to go back into work with students. I think those of you that know that I was doing that, the one worry I had was I was going to have a classroom with 30 of them, and I don't. I get to pull them in and work with them and then send them back out, sort of like a grandparent. I can hug my grandkids and then send them off. And so it worked. It's worked pretty well. And I wanted to, in that theme, then I wanted to also kind of pose the question, how often do you find yourself, or do we find ourselves prompting our children or our grandchildren to say thank you? Whenever they're offered a treat, whenever they're given something, a friend gives them something, we find ourselves saying, now, what do you say? I find myself doing that at school right now with these younger kids who don't understand that you need to appreciate and tell people that you appreciate it. You know, we want our children to be respectful and use good manners. That's why we teach them to say that, along with many other things. But I wonder, in our attempt to produce properly mannered children, if we actually overlooked the thankfulness within those words. Thank you. Do we bring our children to a place of thankfulness where it's more than just polite, but a recognizable part of their person? Are we at a place where thankfulness is recognizable in our personhood, if you will? Can you see in their countenance? Can you see? Do we teach that part of it, or is it just a group of words that we have them put together to say, to placate whoever they're giving, being given something from? A few years ago, the Peanuts cartoon pictured Charlie Brown bringing out Snoopy's dinner on Thanksgiving Day. But it was just his usual dog food in a bowl. And Snoopy took one look at the dog food and said, "This isn't fair. The rest of the world is eating turkey with all the trimmings, and all I get is dog food because I'm a dog. All I get is dog food." He stood there and he was staring at it for a moment. And then he said, "Well, I guess I could be worse. I could be the turkey." You know, there's very little joy in Snoopy's thankfulness because his thankfulness was based on comparisons. And I know many times I've compared what's been going on in my life with someone else's and find myself less than joyful, even though I'm saying I'm thankful, because I don't really feel like sometimes maybe I got my just rewards or whatever. I don't even know what it is I'm thinking sometimes. You know, his thankfulness was based on the fact that he was better off than that turkey. And therein lies that small lesson that when we're down in the dumps and full of complaints because life isn't fair, we should recognize that there are so many others far worse off than we are. We should stop complaining, but when it comes to our thankfulness, the basis should never be on, "Whew, I'm thankful I'm not her," or, "Boy, I'm so thankful I don't have to live like that." That's not what we're supposed to be about with thankfulness. It isn't a comparison. I mean, the other side of that comparison is, man, how come they have so much and I have so little? Constantly comparing over things, and that's not what it's all about. Thankfulness is much more than comparison. Thankfulness is so much more than having enough food or money or a nice warm house. I mean, I'm not belittling that. And I'm not saying that there's been times I haven't looked and thought, "There but by the grace of God might I be." I realize that. But that's not really the basis for where my thankfulness should be. Thankfulness is a state of being. It's a way of life. And we usually fail to live in a state of thankfulness because we take it all for granted. Referring back to my young Noah that has shared his snotty nose and cough with me. And one thing that he does every day, even though he's very obstinate, very stubborn, has special needs, is he always smiles. And I can tell he really is happy. He's happy to be alive. He's not happy to be at school sometimes, not happy to be with me, but he's happy. And it just emanates from him. And you can tell that he's happy until I stifle it and make him do something. Then he's not so happy. We're kind of like the world traveler who's been everywhere. We've seen everything, and he takes it for granted. Takes those things, those blessings and those beauties, all of that he's seen. We've kind of become so accustomed to our blessings that they fail to excite us and generate any kind of thankfulness in us. We just take them for granted. It's been said that if the stars came out only once a year, everybody would stay up all night just to behold them. We've seen the stars so often, though, that we don't bother to look at them anymore. And then when we live in town, we can't even see most of them. In that same manner, we've grown accustomed to our blessings, and quite frankly, we've become spoiled. And I say we, as in especially our country, this congregation, the people here in this area and throughout this country, we've become spoiled. I want to read from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 to 19. Excuse me. It came to pass as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Galilee and Samaria. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." And he said unto them, "Go, show yourselves unto the priests." And it came to pass as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, he turned back and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus, answering, said, "Were there not 10 that were cleansed? Where are the other 9? In this reading, Luke kind of shares with us the account of one leper who wasn't spoiled, so to speak. And there have been a lot of guesses. I mean, I've never really thought much about it, but there have been people who pose the question, where'd the other 9 go? What'd they do? Did they rush off and just forget it all? We don't know, and it doesn't matter. Our focus really is on that one who was thankful. He provides us with some very important lessons on thankfulness. Most of you are aware that lepers were shunned in society. And I think in some societies they still are. They had to be outside the city walls. They had to shout unclean whenever anybody came close to warn them. Or if they were walking through, they had to make sure, you know, give us a wide berth, we're unclean. The first century belief was that God gave leprosy to punish those who were sinful and disobedient. If this was your station in life, being looked down upon by society, being told that you have leprosy because you found disfavor with God, I wonder how much joy and thankfulness you would have. I wonder how much thankfulness, and I say, when I say you, I'm talking about myself many times, because I wonder about that. I believe this leper maintained a spirit of joy and thankfulness, which enabled him to more fully appreciate what Christ had done for him. The doors that had suddenly opened up because of what Christ had done to him. And if you think about it, we have all experienced some form of leprosy in our time, where we felt separated and alone, whether it's from the death of a spouse, a loved one, the loss of a job, the infliction of emotional pain. And we've asked God, well, we've all had circumstances in life where we've lived outside the city, where we've paused and said, "Why? What did I do to deserve this?" My understanding and relationship with God tells me that the leper didn't deserve this. And the same can be said for each of us in our situations with our bouts of leprosy, if you will. But do we share something else in common with the leper? Do we also share his thankful attitude? Does your life represent a spirit of thankfulness? Is that what you try to instill in those around you? I can think of folks, and I'm sure each of you know people, who have an expression, an attitude, as I shared with you about Noah, an aura that exudes happiness. It's contagious. And it's a thankfulness for life. Are you one of those people that exudes that thankfulness? Or are you more like Snoopy? Said, well, I'm glad I've got that. Wish I had that, but I'm thankful for this. You know, what kind of thankfulness do we have? Being thankful is so much more than like having a private prayer or a public proclamation. Being thankful is an expression through your attitude. The leper also teaches us that thankfulness completes the healing. Healing means to be made whole. When all 10 of those lepers found physical healing, only one of them found a wholeness. All the rest discovered that they didn't have this disease anymore, but we don't know what happened after that. But obviously, this 10th recognized something else. Many of you know, excuse me, both Debbie and I have had some major surgeries. And thankfully, each of our surgeries has been successful. Both of us have made pretty good physical recoveries. And in each instance, I offered prayers of thanksgiving for our healing. But I wondered, to what degree would I have been thankful and would I have found wholeness had our surgeries not been successful? It reminds me of Ephesians 4:6, where it says, God is through all and in all. And I'm not suggesting that we thank God for all the crisis and pain that we get, but I am suggesting that we maybe thank God for his continued faithfulness and presence in the midst of crisis. I'm suggesting that maybe we thank God for the strength and growth that we experience during a crisis. As some of you know, I coach cross country in the fall and soccer in the spring, and I've been known to say more than once, if it doesn't kill you, it will make you stronger. It's usually when one of the girls is whining because they're tired and they don't want to run this next lap or whatever. And I quickly point out, I have not killed anyone yet in the 45 years I've coached. That doesn't usually make them feel any better, but it makes me feel better that I said it. And what we've discovered, especially this season, the other coach and I, that some of these girls, one in particular who had been a real whiner, when she comes to practice now, she gets to business. She no longer is a whiner and a complainer. And I don't take credit for it. I'm just saying that she pushed through whatever that issue was she was having, and she's moved forward into a different level. And that's what God wants us to do. We need to push forward through that comparison level and move into that next level. We need to thank him for the shower of mercies that he soaks onto us during all of our crisis. Crises don't always turn out the way we want them to. You know, this isn't one of these Disney specials that we live in where everything is fine and dandy in the end. And the pain that we experience, be it physical or emotional, is very real. But we can still find healing and we can still find wholeness by maintaining a spirit of thankfulness. We must look past the current situation and acknowledge that he's in control. Therein lies the rub. I'm married to somebody who has a difficult time, had a difficult time letting someone else have some control. And I don't mean that in a bad way. I'm just saying she felt much more comfortable if she knew she was in control of situations. And as most of you know, we lost a daughter when we lived in Texas, and immediately we discovered we had no control. And in hindsight, we looked back and we saw as we went through that experience that God was holding us. And once that pain subsided, we realized this and we were very thankful. We, like they always say, hindsight is always 20/20. But we saw we were in a position to make some very, very bad mistakes financially as well as otherwise because we weren't thinking. We're traveling that road of grief. But we also recognized that God was holding on to us. And once we realized that, we thanked him for it. And we continually thank him for that. And something that dawned on me, I mean, this is no realization to anybody but myself, maybe you guys already know it, is, you know, during a crisis, I guess most of us have heard this at one point or another, you're going to either run to God or you're going to run from him. That fight or flight that every one of us have. It's human nature to have. We found out what had happened with our daughter. I found out later that many of my family thought I was going to be running the opposite way. And for some reason, I know it's because of the grounding of my parents, I ran towards him instead of away from him. And that was a blessing for all of us. I believe the leper maintained a spirit of thankfulness throughout the battle of his leprosy. I don't think he was any different after he was healed than he was before. Now, again, that's just my opinion, but the way that we live when nobody's looking is what we really are. If we're thankful for something, we're not thankful for it only, well, if we're truly thankful, let me rephrase that. If we're truly thankful for something, we're not truly just thankful for it whenever somebody hears us saying it or sees us showing that appreciation. We demonstrate that in our daily lives, in everything that we do, and it shows. In Psalms, we find this in chapter 26. 28, verses 6 through 9. Blessed be the Lord, because he hath heard the voice of my supplications. The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusteth in him, and I am helped. Therefore my heart greatly rejoiceth, and with my song will I praise him. The Lord is their strength, and he is, and he is the saving strength of his anointed. Save thy people and bless thine inheritance. Feed them also and lift up them up forever. The psalmist is certain, he had certainly maintained a spirit of thankfulness. And even though the first half of that psalm was a cry out for help, the psalmist has cried out in desperation, pleading for God's deliverance. And then his words show us that he has found that wholeness. He says that God has heard the sound of his pleadings. He recognizes it. His heart trusts God, and he knows that God is his saving refuge. Thankfulness is an attitude. It's a way of life. It enables healing to bring wholeness. When I begin making comparisons, I'm reminded of Matthew 5:47 that says, and it tells us, he makes the sun rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain unto the just and the unjust. Attitude is key to this. As I tell my students all the time, one thing we can always control is ourselves and how we are going to act. Now, we can shake our fists at God and say, why me? Or we can say, help me get through this. It's a decision that we make. At times we may forget it. I know I have. Excuse me. However, repentance, trust, and faith will help us remember. These are the basic cornerstones that will sustain us through anything life throws at us and will take us into the world beyond, to a home in heaven, to an eternity with God. What God has started, He will sustain. What God has begun, He will finish. We can be assured of that. He's not going to let us go. Mark Twain was once contracted to write articles for $5 a word. And that was a lot of money back in his day. And he was asked by an interviewer one time, what was the most significant word? And his simple answer was, the word is thanks. To me, two statements that can change a situation are I'm sorry and thanks. These words can stop an argument. They can begin a friendship. Many times I've experienced the reaction of an angry person when I say I'm sorry. It'll stop them dead in their tracks. And also the opposite will happen if you don't say I'm sorry, or if you refuse to move forward. They can build, those words can build bridges. They can mend relationships. As most of you know, my mom passed away last year, a little over a year ago. And so my siblings and I had the opportunity, I guess you'd call it, to work together to get everything sold and sell her house. And one of my siblings, just before everything was really getting going, decided he and his wife were going to move out of state. So the other three of us felt put upon, so to speak. And I won't say, we get along pretty well, but I won't say that I was really appreciative of what he had done, because he left us hanging sometimes. Excuse me. And I would try and send a text or something, and he would delay responding. And finally, I called him, and I just told him, you know, I just want to hear your voice. I just want to talk to you. I wanted to see him, but, I mean, he's in Florida, and I'm here, so that didn't happen. But I apologized to him and told him, I'm sorry if there's been a miscommunication. And suddenly things seemed totally different. And that's the way it is. It's amazing. And maybe some of you have experienced it. I know I have. Somebody who's really angry about something, and you'll just say, I'm sorry, or what can I do to make it better? And suddenly, they're your friend. Or at least they're not your enemy anymore. The psalmist's words acknowledge that to live under God's claim, to live as God intends, is to live as part of God's people. And God's people live in dependence upon God rather than upon self. We must recognize this and not just think it's a coincidence that things happen. I want you to consider for a second an example of a lady. She was fighting to find a parking spot in a busy mall. She had a lot to do, and it started to rain. So she was asking God, hey, help. She said, God, can you help me find a spot near the mall entrance? And as soon as she said it, a car backed up right in front of the doors. And she went right in and parked there and said, never mind, God, something just opened up. And how often do we do that? It's a coincidence. It's not a quick response to a request that we gave to God. It's just a coincidence. You know, we may think about it, but we do that. I do that. I can't assume that you do that, but I do that. We can't behave as if things are a coincidence. Got to give credit where credit is due. Those who receive life as a gift to be lived in dependence upon God will be characterized by gratitude. And that drives them into the community of God's people. As I was going through this last part, the thing that really struck me is the idea of community. Some people, I guess I'll poke the bear or whatever. Some people really struggled when they changed the name of the church to the Community of Christ. But I feel like in the scriptures it talks about community constantly. And the right kind of community can do the right kinds of things in so many ways. That's part of why we gather each week. A relationship with God is personal. It's not dependent upon the church. God's desire is that we live out our faith in the community with fellow believers. The reason I come here is because I get strength from those who are around. It rejuvenates. It reminds me I'm not the only one. Even though I'm out doing something and I know in the back of my mind I'm not the only one, it's always nice to have that affirmation by seeing each one who's here. When we live life with a spirit of thankfulness, we realize that life is a gift. I'm sorry. It's a gift from God. And in gratitude for that gift, we're driven into the community of God's people. We want to share that. The Psalms have said, save your people. Bless your heritage. Be their shepherd and carry them forward. Those words are about community. And it is within the community of God's people that we more richly and completely experience the thankfulness and fullness of life. We have so much to be thankful for. God's grace has been extended to us, and there have been role models that have helped us to see His grace. I sat down for just a few minutes this morning after I was looking through this and wrote down a few. And these are individuals. See, in fact, the ones I wrote down are all, they've all passed away now. Don Lentz, Denzel West, my mom and dad. They've all passed away, but I'm part of their heritage because what they shared with me is something I'm trying to share with someone else. I want to be the role model that they were. Every time I think of it, I thank God. Our role models may have been a parent, a Sunday school teacher, an aunt, an uncle, a grandparent, or might have been another member of a congregation that you're going to. And as you're recalling them now, your heart beats a little faster and you want to smile and you say, every time I think of you, I thank God. I think if you guys all took a moment, you could all think of someone that you could place into that category. So remember, being thankful is an attitude for living. Thankfulness is a part of being made whole. Thankfulness is recognizing life as a gift from God that drives us into the community of God's people. And imagine how much joy and appreciation if someone was to come to you and say, I'm thankful that you helped me get where I am today. And many times people will do that, maybe not in words, but in actions.
Thank you. First of all, I want to say thank you, David, for making us think. Father, I would close this service asking for your protection, for your watch care over all of these folks who will be in need sometime before they come back. And Father, I would close this service asking for the congregation to join me in the prayer that Jesus taught, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation. Evil, for thine is the glory, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.